I light the chalice, you are invited to acknowledge the gratitude for the earth. Think about the multitude of blessings from this planet. Sun, soil, air, water, food, and many more. Reflections by Stephen Schick. We have gathered, bearing our presence, carrying our countenance, like mirrors, we reflect all we have suffered, all we have celebrated, all we have collected from life before arriving here. Darkness of winter, rebirth of spring, abundance of autumn, they are with us. We make this space sacred by all this and by our resolve to project onto the pathway of tomorrow our best reflections.
Welcome to our Earth Day service, Pathways to a New Earth Day Story. For today, Kent Newman is our celebrant, Nancy Bratt is our pianist, and our pastoral care person for this week is Susan Gellinger. Please keep your microphones muted during the entire service. After the service, you are welcome to turn on your microphone and join us in the coffee hour breakout rooms. We begin by acknowledging that we are gathered on the traditional, ancestral, unceded land of the Bahokie or Iowa, Sac, and Meskwaki peoples. We offer our respect to their elders, both past and present, as well as future generations. We recognize that our presence here today is the result of the ongoing exclusions and erasure of Indigenous peoples who were the original stewards of the land. As these words of acknowledgement are spoken and heard, let the ties that the nations have to their traditional homelands be renewed and reaffirmed. Our gathering song this morning is number 21, For the Beauty of the Earth, and the words will be posted in the chat.
For the glory of the skies, for Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Des Moines, digital service. My name is Kent Newman. My pronouns are he, him, his, and I am the celebrant for this morning's service. Whether you're with us for the day or here for a lifetime, we are glad that you have chosen to join us online. Everyone is welcome to join us for a service, whether or not you live in Des Moines or have ever physically been in Des Moines. Whoever you are, we hope that you find something here today to help you on your life's journey. Today is our annual Earth Day service, where we give thanks for this beautiful planet, for sustaining life, thanks for the importance of nature as a critical element of our spirituality, growing awareness of the impacts of all human activities on the planet and the atmosphere, especially during this modern era, and issue an urgent call for redoubling public and private efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and carbon. Our members, Linda Lemons, Janice Hawkins, and Ron Heidemann, are leaders of the Pachamama Alliance in Iowa and develop the elements of our service today. Pachamama Alliance is a growing global movement that you will learn more about today. In 1962, Rachel Carson published Silent Spring, an environmental science book documenting the adverse environmental effects of pesticides. It helped inspire an environmental movement that led to the creation of the Federal Environmental Protection Agency. In 1969, there was a huge oil spill off the Santa Barbara coast, and the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland caught fire. California Republican Congressman Pete McCloskey and Democratic Senator Gaylord Nelson of Wisconsin witnessed the oil spill, and they hired a young activist named Dennis Hayes to organize teach-ins at college campuses around the country. They changed the name to Earth Day and broadened the focus and organizing to a range of organizations, including faith groups. This is the Cuyahoga River on fire here. And this burned for like a week or more. On April 22nd, 1970, 20 million Americans filled the streets, parks, and auditoriums to demonstrate against the impacts of 150 years of industrial development that had left a growing legacy of serious human health impacts. I remember the first Earth Day in the spring of my 10th grade year. I was taking biology and we had a small demonstration. There was a growing awareness of nature, the importance of the natural world in our lives, and new awareness of the collective impacts of modern civilization on our planet. This calls forth our seventh principle, respect for the interdependent web of which we are all a part. For our special music today, I'm going to play a song that was a top 40 hit for the band Spirit in 1970, Nature's Way. Alan Smith and I have been playing music together for over 20 years. Alan came over one day last summer excited to record this song, and I play this in tribute to him. Alan had a serious stroke later last summer and is still in rehab and assisted living at Bishop Drum in Johnston, and I just visited him on Friday. So let me now share this recording of Nature's Way. Hopefully you can hear this time.
We've got that. Let's do it now, shall we?
Yep. Is it coming through?
Thank you.
Okay, and now it's time for the story for all ages.
Now we will hear the story, Brother Eagle, Sister Sky, and a message from Chief Seattle. It'll be read by Greta Hayes, a member of our church, and illustrated by Susan Jeffers.
How can you buy the sky? Chief Seattle began. How can you own the rain and the wind? My mother told me. Every part of this earth is sacred to our people. Every pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every meadow and humming insect, all are holy in the memory of our people. The bear, the deer, the great eagle, these are our brothers. Bear, the voice of my ancestors said to me,
the great eagle,
the shining water that moves in the streams brothers. And rivers is not simply water, but the blood of your grandfather's grandfather. Each ghostly reflection in the clear waters of the lake tell memories in the life of our people. The water's murmur is the voice of your great-grandmother. The rivers are our brothers. They quench our thirst, they carry our canoes, and feed our children. You must give to the rivers the kindness you would give to any brother. The voice of my grandfather said to me, the air is precious. It shares its spirit with all the life it supports. The wind that gave me my first breath also received my last sigh. You must keep the land and air apart and sacred as a place where one can go to taste the wind that is sweetened by the meadow flowers. When the last red man and woman had vanished with their wilderness and their memories the only shadow of a cloud moving across the prairie, will the shores and forests still be there? Will there be any of the spirit of my people left? My ancestors said to me, this we know. The earth does not belong to us. We belong to the earth. What befalls the earth befalls all the sons and daughters of the earth. The voice of my grandmother said to me, teach your children what you have been taught. The earth is our mother. Hear my voice and the voice of my ancestors, Chief Seattle said. The destiny of your people is a mystery to us. What will happen when the buffalo are all slaughtered? Will the wild horses tamed? What will happen when the secret corners of the forest are heavy with the scent of many men? When the view of the ripe hills is blotted by talking wires, where will the thicket be? Gone. Where will the eagle be? Gone. And what will happen when we say goodbye to the swift pony in the hunt? It will be the end of living and the beginning of survival. This we know. All things are connected like the blood that unites us. We do not weave the web of life. We are merely a strand in it. Whatever we do to the web, we do to ourselves. We love this earth as a newborn loves his mother heartbeat. We will sell you our land and care for it as we have cared for. Hold in your mind the memory of the land as it when you receive it. Preserve the land and the air and the rivers for your children's children and love it as we have loved it.
And now it's time for a brief update from our member Elaine Imlau on the 1921 version of our First Unitarian Fabulously Fun Food Fair fundraiser and more. Elaine.
Good morning, everybody. I can tell you right now that we have 14 events that have been closed out, all sold out, but there's still 23 open. And I know there are a lot of you out there who have been to food fair events in the past that are not on my bidders list. Mary Hayes, you're one of them. What's happening? Are you interested in some of them? You gotta unmute. And now try it.
Now, can you hear me?
Now I can hear you.
Okay.
So you haven't signed up yet?
I have signed up.
I don't see your name on the list.
All right.
How'd you do it?
I don't know. That's the trouble. I don't know how to do it.
I think Kathy Beck told me that she bought one for you, but you said you wanted some more. So
that's right.
Yep. So those of you out there that are confused with how this works online, there are 40 other people who have purchased and bid on things that can help you. Reach out to your friends. And those of you who have already done it, reach out to your friends who you know are technically challenged and please help them out. We have a couple more weeks to go and there's over 100 slots available for in-person events and there's at least 20 or more left for kids and lots of things to bid on. So please get online, get some help. I'm putting the information in the chat. Don't be shy. And events are outside through September in small groups of 10. So we're trying to be as safe as possible. Hope you sign up. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Elaine. And now it's time for our offertory. Take it away, Ron.
Pachamama Alliance Iowa is part of a global movement focused on building a thriving, equitable, socially just, life-affirming future for all through an informed reallocation of our resources. Time and treasures are two of our resources. Please consider giving some of your treasure to the social justice work of this church.
The morning offering will now be given and received through the link in the chat. Half of this electronic plate goes to the social justice programs of the church and half to our faith and action partners, Planned Parenthood of the Heartland and Central Iowa Immigrant Support Coalition. A church is not the building, but a community. As a community of human hands and human hearts, we come together to share our laughter and our tears and to minister to one another as we struggle with life's sorrows and celebrate life's joys.
In addition to sharing the names of anyone who could use special care and attention today, we also want to acknowledge the destruction of our earth, plants and animals, as we are now in the midst of a sixth extinction caused by human destruction of our earth. Please note the names of plants and animals that have now become extinct and that are shared in the chat.
Let us share together now the names of anyone we know who could use some special care and attention. As we type their names into the chat, please include the names of plants and animals who become extinct. May the light of our community shine on the broken places of the world, and may we travel hand in hand with all those who fight for equity and justice in human relations. May the work of our hands and our hearts support and comfort all those who are marginalized, oppressed, silenced, or at risk. May we be called to mindful action by the needs of those who struggle against violence, pain, degradation, and destruction. May those who are grieving be comforted. May those who are tired find rest. May the broken places be healed. May those who are filled with joy and laughter be abundant. Now together we light three virtual candles, one for the joys and sorrows we have shared, one for the names we have written, and one last candle for all the joys and all the sorrows that are deeply held but remain unspoken here today.
Comfort me, comfort me, comfort me, oh my soul. Comfort me, comfort me, comfort me, oh my soul. Sing with me, yeah. Sing with me, sing with me, oh my soul. Sing with me.
So what was that call? Back in 1968, I was a Peace Corps volunteer deep in the Amazon rainforest, and the shamans told me the prophecy of the eagle and the condor. The prophecy says that back long, long ago, human societies would take two different courses. One would be the path of the eagle, which was said to be the path of the mind, of intellect, of science and technology and industry. The other would be the path of the condor, the path of the heart, of intuition, of passion, of connection to the earth. And according to the prophecy, these two parts of human societies would go in very different directions for hundreds of years. And then in the late 1400s, they would come together and clash. And the eagle peoples would be so powerful, so strong, that they would practically drive the condor people into extinction, but not quite. And of course, we know that's what happened. Columbus. After that, the industrial nations of the world practically drove the indigenous nations into extinction, but not quite. The prophecy goes on to say that about 500 years later, at the end of the 1900s, the opportunity would arise for the eagle and the condor to soar together in one sky, to mate and to create human societies at a new level of consciousness. And so it was about that time, in the early 1990s, that the Achua made the call from the Amazon that Lynn referred to. They told me that the world is as you dream it, and that the eagle cultures have had a dream that's become far too materialistic. They asked for help in saving their forests and their cultures. They asked us to help them get rid of this dysfunctional dream and the encroaching oil companies and the extremely dangerous situation that all of them were facing. But their call was not just about them. It was a global message. It was a message that they said came from the rainforest itself, from the heart of Pachamama. The future of the world, they said, depended on us coming together, eagles and condors, and realizing the prophecy and creating situations where human societies can rise to higher levels of consciousness. The three of us then assembled a group of people, and we went out to the Achua and met with them and spent time with them. And that was the beginning of this partnership, the Pachamama Alliance. And so that's why you're here. You've heard the call. You're hearing the call. Together, we're going to manifest that ancient prophecy. Together, we're going to help human societies rise to higher levels of consciousness. Are you ready to do that?
Our meditation reading today is The Peace of Wild Things by Wendell Berry. Please join me in 1 minute of silent thought, meditation, or prayer following this poem. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lay down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free.
Arkan Lushwala is a rare indigenous bridge of the global north and south, carrying spiritual traditions from the Andes in his native Peru. Here's Arkan's video, The Gift of Being Human.
For indigenous people to investigate and to find out truth has always been very important. Our methodology, the way we have been doing it for generations, is different than the modern scientific method. We have our ways of finding truth. Vision quest, certain dances, ceremonies, powerful ceremonies, where our mind is really, really open and can see the depth of realities that normally cannot be seen. By doing this, we discovered today the same that our ancestors and people have discovered for generations. And this is that we human beings, what we have all in common as a species, the gift that we all have in common, even if each person has a particular different gift, we all have one in common. And this gift is that we have the capacity to be the caretakers of all life. With the same methodology, with our ceremonies and our prayers, we have been able to recognize the essence of other forms of life. What is their medicine? And each one has one. Every form of life on earth has a medicine. The stars, the sun, the moon have a medicine. Power, a gift, and everyone has one that is different. So we know the gift and the talent and the medicine of many of them, and therefore we know that we are the ones who have been given the task of taking care of everything else. We have a very strong influence on everything else. This is what humans enjoy doing from the beginning of times, using their creativity, their capacity to create beauty, their beautiful, powerful capacity to pray with ceremony, with singing, with dancing, to create a vibration, an energy that goes everywhere and feeds everyone, feeds the spirit of everyone, keeps things in balance. The other forms of life used to recognize us as being the people who do that, and they respected us as we respected them. Something happened and it got reversed. Instead of being the caretakers, instead of being the ones recognized by all the other forms of life as caretakers, as the ones who nourish everything else and keep it in balance, now all the other forms of life are afraid of us. They are afraid that when we come to their homes, their ocean, their forest, their mountain, their desert, that we come only to take something and to destroy their home, destroy their source of food, contaminate. How did this happen? We reversed our original talent, our original gift, into the opposite. So, remembering, massively remembering, all human beings, remembering all of us, who we are, that we are the caretakers of this planet, the awareness of this, can bring major healing to ourselves and to the earth. Anyone can stand up today in front of a sacred fire, in front of a mountain, in front of a tree, and say, I am back. I forgot. I lost my path. I didn't know who I was. Pachamama, Mother Earth, great power, all beings that share this planet with us humans, I am back. I have returned home. I know I am a caretaker. I am back.
Our centering song today is number 203, All Creatures of the Earth and Sky. And once again, I think the words are on the screen in this hymn.
Linda and I will each be sharing our reflections this morning. Buckminster Fuller said, "You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." Well, one of those new models is the concept of buen vivir, which is Spanish for living well. Jocelyn Mercado wrote, "Our Western worldview is based on a never-ending development, an emphasis on the rights of the individual, personal salvation, and capitalism. We are taught from an early age that materialism and consumption are necessary aspects of life. There is an ever-present dualism which separates society from nature." Now, this concept was embraced in parts of Latin America because they noticed that development projects, which were to bring wealth, ended up extracting natural resources and poverty levels increased. The indigenous people who lived there lived in a sustainable and peaceful manner, and they did not feel that the Western ways were benefiting them. And the people in this area also highly valued preserving, protecting, and respecting nature, which is a valuable part of the community. The constitutions of Ecuador and Bolivia today, in fact, reflect that concept. The indigenous traditions that have existed for centuries allows these cultures to live sustainably and in many cases without a need for money or traditional jobs. Work is shared, food is distributed to those who need it most. The only resources from the environment are those that are needed for survival. Nature is not harmed and is allowed to regenerate in order to enhance the lives of future generations. The non-human life forms, such as plants, animals, the earth, spirits of the ancestors, have their own free will and feelings and are respected as such. This concept is really a radical departure from the current predominant worldview, yet parts of it have crept into Western culture. For example, some of you may be aware that austere living is becoming popular. That is the adopting of a zero-waste lifestyle, the tiny house movement, and returning to a natural vegetarian diet. As well, eco-friendly practices or green practices can be found in a number of businesses and corporations, and using alternative energy sources to reduce consumption and the deletion of natural resources can also lead to sustainability. Now, while buen vivir is a visionary concept, it's a portal into the era of the great social change. It opens our eyes to what could be possible and positions us to reach a greater understanding of our own human potential. With that, we invite you to join with the Pachamama Alliance and find out how you can take action toward changing the paradigms of our modern world. Engage with our collective responsibility as human beings for our role in shaping the evolution of life on Earth.
I am Linda Lemons, and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. I come with deep gratitude for my 33-year relationship with Unitarian Universalism and the challenges, joys, resources, opportunities, and lens or worldview it has offered me. With this gratitude, I share my reflections regarding the pathways to a new Earth Day story, and for the challenging experience of integrating the foundational values of a new story into my mind, heart, and body, based on a desire to know for myself what I can offer and what is mine to do. The vision that Pachamama Alliance is hoping to bring forth is an environmentally sustainable, spiritually fulfilling, socially just human presence on this planet. They believe this is possible if we change the story we are telling ourselves about the world. I think the UUs describe this as our ongoing search for truth and meaning, and the Buddhists would use language of mental formations, and with awareness and compassion of the pain, we move from being stuck in suffering to see with new eyes the pathway to act and move forward. So I ask myself, what if we viewed the world from the prophecy of the eagle and the condor, and we knew it was now time to soar together in the sky, bringing forth the new level of consciousness, one that values the interconnected gifts of the female eagle and the male condor, knowing intuitively the timing of which quality was needed to move forward. What if we could grieve when it was time to grieve, clarifying what we wanted to take with us and what was time to leave behind? Wow. Think of all the rigid dualities, walls of separation, blaming, attacking, shaming, hiding, and denying we could transform. So the contribution I offer for our consideration as we bring forth a new Earth Day story is naming the practice and skills to be aware, valuing the importance of slowing down, breathing, and focusing on the current moment, even if it is a pandemic that has to teach us this. To notice what we are experiencing in our minds, bodies, and hearts, allowing ourselves to see the violence and losses in ourselves and the world, being in community with others who understand this practice, and then knowing when it is time to offer one's gifts or take action, whether that be of the spider weaving a web or a cat climbing a tree, and bringing forth an environmentally sustainable, spiritually fulfilling, socially just world for all, a new dream for humanity.
My name is Ron Heidemann. My pronouns are he, him, and his. In the article, How Social Justice and Environmental Justice Are Intrinsically Interconnected, author Haley Hansel writes, "The interconnectedness of daily human life and the state of the earth often goes unexamined. But at this point in human history, we cannot afford to separate these conversations. The assumptions that many people carry, that the earth is separate from us and thus exploitable, are paralleled by assumptions that some people are different and inherently disposable. When some people have access to resources that help them relieve climate impacts while others don't, that becomes a social justice issue. A UN report on climate change stated that it is the poor who will suffer the most as the effects of climate change continue. People who are marginalized are especially vulnerable to climate change," it said. The Human Impact Report, published by the Global Humanitarian Forum in 2009, said that 300,000 people a year are already dying from the effects of climate change, and another 4 billion are vulnerable to negative side effects, such as water shortages, extreme weather, food insecurity, reduced agricultural productivity, loss of low-lying lands, desertification, loss of biodiversity and ecosystem services, and spread of diseases such as malaria. Although these effects are not exclusive to the poor have limited ability to cope with them. A decline in crop yields will first and foremost affect the countries and the people who aren't able to afford higher priced crops. The poor are also hit hardest in weather-related disasters, such as heat waves or storm surges. And the number of natural disasters between 2000 and 2009 was around 3 times higher than in the 1980s. Almost entirely because of climate-related events. As the poor find themselves subject to these adversities, it makes it even more difficult to fight poverty. Pachamama Alliance Iowa values experiencing the interconnected web of all existence. We acknowledge we each will be continuing to change and evolve as we all transition to an ecological, restorative, resilient, life-affirming worldview, where we are accountable for how our actions impact both ourselves and others. As I extinguish the chalice, a reading by Rashi Joan Halifax. May we spread justice and mercy in every direction. May we exercise the right to vote and vote wisely. May we send our voice and help others to do so in order to end racist and sexist violence in our world today. May we end our addiction to our lifestyles and recognize the catastrophic impacts of our consumeristic habits on climate and our earth. And may we end the supremacy of the privileged few so all can enjoy equal justice and equal care. This includes working toward the transformation of our economic system, our system of government, how we educate and care for our young, how we treat our elders, and how we treat our earth and indigenous peoples. At this very time, there is no question that we need dramatic and systemic change. We together can make good trouble and bend the arc of the moral universe toward justice. We can do it whether we are a contemplative or social activist, whether young or old, whether rich or living in sacrifice zones. And clearly, we must do this now.
Bringing ourselves into the present moment doesn't mean we lose connection with past or future. We are shaped by our history as a part of who we are. What we add is intentionality. The choice making is our bridge to the future, as each intention represents a preference for the kind of world we want. Our intentionality endows the present moment with direction. Go in peace, may it be so.
Last room today is Young People Marching. And following this, please stick around and we will split into breakout rooms with a question for us all to think about. Here's the question. It will take all of us working together, sharing our gifts and talents to envision and clarify next steps based on a worldview of love, caring, regeneration, deep democracy, social equity, ecological and social well-being. How can you help and be part of this?
There is no middle ground when it comes to the climate and ecological emergency.
Young people marching, striking for climate. Millions and millions of young people marching, marching for our planet, marching for their lives. Young people speaking their truth to power. The science is clear, it's late in the hour for climate action, reducing GHGs. Decades of lies, decades of denial, turned up the heat, engulfed us in fire. Decades of obstruction, though people knew better, caused this climate emergency, and we gotta set ourselves free of this climate emergency, climate emergency. Young people dreaming a clean new economy, a green new deal, keeping it real. Young people calling out extinction rebellion. Greta Thunberg in Sweden got
everybody started. Now millions are marching the whole world over. Young people marching, marching for our lives. Decades of lies, decades of denial. Turned up the heat, engulfed us in fire. Decades of obstruction, though people knew better. Caused this climate emergency. Now we gotta set ourselves free of this climate emergency. Climate emergency. Young people marching, striking for climate. Millions and millions of young people marching, marching for our planet. They're marching for our lives. Young people marching, they're marching for our lives.